been in the past about our openness to looking into the last 20-year war, mistakes made, what can be learned from that. But let me get you something more official from our team. Go ahead.
Thank you so much, Jen. On the new requirements for all travelers getting tested 24 hours before arrival in the U.S., who's going to be responsible for covering the costs for tests for Americans? Will that be individuals or insurance companies?
For Americans who are coming back into the United States?
Correct.
Let me check. It's a good question, and I just want to make sure I give you accurate information.
And another on the testing requirements. In many countries, it's still very difficult to get COVID tests, particularly ones with less than 24-hour turnaround in a timely manner. So what considerations are being made on this, given the new requirements?
Well, as we're implementing any of these policies, we obviously take into consideration, as you know, in our prior announcement about requirement of vaccination, in countries where that wasn't available. I will check and see if there's any exemptions or anything that is going to be applicable in the same regard.
Can I ask you one on student debt as well? Is the administration at all considering continuing to defer student loan payments past January, or to at least keep interest rates at 0% in order to provide relief for Americans who are still hurting? And if not,
I don't have anything to preview about a decision on that front. I'm not sure one's been made yet. Go ahead.
What's the administration's response to OPEC Plus saying they're going to go ahead with their planned output increase? And in light of that and the dropping oil prices, is the administration reconsidering its SPR plans?
On the second part, we have no plans to reconsider. On the first part, we appreciate the close coordination over the recent weeks with our partners, Saudi Arabia, the UAE and other OPEC Plus producers to help address price pressures. We welcome the decision today to continue the 400,000 barrels per day increase. Together with our recent coordinated release from the SPR, we believe this should help facilitate the global economic recovery. And the president is committed to doing everything in his power and work with other countries to bring down costs for the American people and continue our strong economic recovery. As you know, this is an issue not just happening in the United States, but around the world. And hence openness to close coordination on it.
Just to follow up on one of the questions that Mike asked.
Sure.
Right when the infrastructure bill passed, you said that one of the things the president would be doing is local TV interviews.
Yeah.
I think he's only done one so
yes.
far. I know that the First Lady did one, I think, more about Christmas yesterday. So
yeah.
Is there a plan for him to do that in a real way in the next couple of weeks?
I would very much like that to happen. We are always competing with time on the schedule. I'm going to be honest. His schedule has been quite packed, but he would like to do it. We're working to get it on the schedule. So I don't have anything to predict or preview for you at this point in time, but hopefully we will be able to add some local interviews in the next couple of weeks. Go ahead.
Thank you. Is there anything beyond economic sanctions that the United States is willing to do if Russia takes more action against Ukraine?
Well, I'm not in a position to preview at this point in time anything we're considering. Obviously, our Secretary of State is still on the ground, I believe, having these conversations with our European partners. And anything we would do in close coordination with them. As you know, one of the areas of discussion has been providing additional assistance, security assistance to Ukraine. I don't know if you're asking about that, but I would point to that. We have provided a great deal of assistance over the course of the last several months. So that's another area, obviously, we would look at. But I don't have anything to preview on any of these fronts at this point in time, other than we are in close coordination, preparing a range of options, and have conveyed directly to the Russians that if they proceed, as they did in 2014, that we have a range of options that we will consider taking.
Yeah, one question on COVID, and I know that you kind of get variations on this a lot, but
yeah.
With the testing, public health people are saying, well, why not just ship these rapid tests to every American household?
Or yeah.
Why not require a vaccine or a test to fly domestically? Why not go further in the direction of you know, public health and mandates, given the potential risk and the fact that we're headed into winter?
Sure. Well, one, I would say that nothing is off the table, including domestic travel. But we do have some strong protections in place already, including requirement of mask wearing, which was extended, doubling of fines if people are not in compliance. How we look at this is, of course, we base our decisions on the advice of the health and medical experts, what's going to be most effective, and what is most implementable implementable. So we look at a range of factors as we make decisions about what steps we can put in place. So again, nothing's off the table, but the announcement we made today is building on steps we've taken to date, significant steps we've taken to date to continue to protect more people, put in place additional precautions that will save more lives.
Can you just tease out what most implementable means? Are you worried about legal challenges? Are you worried about, political blowback?
I think we've taken a number of steps that are not intended to be controversial or divisive, but still may be perceived that way. But our most important factor is what is going to be most effective, and that's what we really base our decisions on. But as you've seen over the past several months, we build on our steps, right? We've continued to add and make vaccines and boosters more available and accessible. Today's a good example of that. We continue to put in place additional travel restrictions as we are announcing today as well. So we will continue to evaluate and assess on a daily basis. If there are additional steps our health and medical team is recommending, we will consider those as well. Go ahead.
Thanks. On the Supreme Court yesterday, again, showed how much the balance has shifted toward conservatives, particularly those justices appointed by Donald Trump. Has any of this changed the president's thinking on embracing any of the proposals to restructure, expand the Supreme Court term limits, anything on that that he might be rethinking given the nature of the court?
Sure. Well, as I think you know, there's a court reform commission that has been working on and putting together a report, something that he will be receiving and will take a look at and review. And that court commission looked at a range of questions. Court expansion is one of them. Term limits is another one. How cases are taken up and considered. This court commission is has a range of viewpoints that is included, so he will take a look and assess that. I don't expect he will have anything to say in advance of that before he reviews it.
Is the plan that he will read that and then sort of make some sort of determination? What is kind of any deliverables from the president in response? There's been some criticism that the commission really lacks much authority, and from progressives say it's toothless. Is there anything that the president is expected to do upon receiving that report?
I don't want to get ahead of the president. I know he looks forward to reviewing it. And I think if you look at the history of the Supreme Court, it was important to the president to have a range of viewpoints that he could look at and assess and look at the historic nature of a lot of these issues. As the former chairman of the Judiciary Committee, he takes the role of the court, the role of institutions quite seriously. But I'm not going to get ahead of him reviewing it. We'll see what he thinks.
Just to clarify, because I know there's been a few different questions on this, on the free COVID testing, is the expectation that Americans will have to file the claim themselves with their insurance companies to get it back?
Okay. Yeah, go ahead.
The president said yesterday that he's optimistic that the new variant won't affect supply chains and sort of push things backward from the progress that has been made in recent weeks. Mm-hmm. But are you similarly optimistic as an administration about the overall economy in the face of the new variant, and in particular the effect that new government restrictions here and around the world might have on economic activity?
It's a great question, and I've talked to our economic team about this as well. And the fact is, this variant we've been aware of it for about a week now, right? And so our economic team will continue to assess, and we will provide updates if needed, if there are areas of concern. Now, what we don't know right now is a lot about the variant, where there's still a lot we need to learn, including how deadly the variant may be, the effectiveness of our vaccines. Those will all be factors as our team looks at the impact. I think what the president was speaking to is his view that there's a lot of progress we've made on the supply chain bottlenecks. We've unfrozen a lot of those issues, and a lot of the suppliers out there and retailers are pretty confident about their ability to get, stock the shelves and make sure that people can go to stores and get what they need. So that's an encouraging sign. We've done a lot to prepare for this moment, but we will continue to assess. And at this point in time, I don't have any new economic projections from our team on it.
Just as a quick follow-up on it, are you all concerned at all that people afraid of catching the virus because of the variant will be less likely to return to work, and that might delay some of what your administration had hoped would be more of a surge back into the job market in January?
Again, really good question. I think right now what our focus is on is encouraging companies and encouraging organizations out there and large entities to take steps to protect their workforce. And that includes, and that's why it's so important for us to continue to advocate for getting people vaccinated, getting people boosted, making sure people are abiding by mask guidance. We know these steps work and they can protect people. And our medical doctors think that they are still going to provide additional protection from this variant. We'll know more in a couple of weeks, which is good, but we've been very focused on that so that employers and companies can also ensure and convey to their workforce that they will be safe and they're abiding by these recommendations.
Go ahead.
Thanks, Jen. Much of the public booster campaign that you all just announced is targeted specifically at getting seniors access to the booster, but just given the early confusion around boosters in the broader public, is there any more campaign that you can think of to target, say, young people, for instance?
Our campaign is actually focused at getting everybody who's eligible boosted, which is anybody over 18 at this point in time. And that's one of the reasons that we have one of the announcements or one of the steps the president's going to talk about today is these mobile clinics or the opportunity for generations of a family to bring their kids, bring their grandparents, and all get vaccinated and boosted at the same time. So our objective is to get every eligible adult boosted, get every eligible adult vaccinated, and we're continuing to build on steps we've taken to increase access, and that's a big part of the president's speech and announcement today.
Then only about 59% of the public are vaccinated, though, and the U.S. is falling behind some of our peer countries in this regard. Are you all considering any strategies maybe from adopting from abroad or considering what public messaging has been successful or not in shifting strategy on this?
Well, more than 82% of the public has received at least one dose. So that's a good step forward. Obviously, we're going to continue to build on that. But the United States has one of the most effective efforts in the world to get people vaccinated, and we'll continue to build on where we've seen success. Go ahead, Karen.
Two questions on boosters, and one's a follow-up to what he was just asking. We've heard the White House say there's 100 million Americans who are eligible for boosters who haven't gotten that shot, and only 44% right now of eligible seniors have gotten their booster. Why does the White House think that the pace of boosters is sluggish at this point? Like, what's not being done to convince Americans who got their shots to get this extra shot? Why is it slower?
Well, it's hard to get into the minds of every American and why they are or aren't getting boosted. So that's a hard question for me to answer effectively from here. What we do know, obviously we don't want to be, we would prefer not to be in a situation where we are dealing with an unknown variant. I think everybody can deal with, understand that. But the fact that people, there are unknowns, and we are out there encouraging people to get boosted at the time where we're still learning more about a variant. We've seen numbers go up. We hope that more people will take this seriously and get boosted. I can't assess, though, why people psychologically are or are not getting boosted.
And the plan that the president's going to talk about today calls for expanding capacity at pharmacies for boosters. What exactly would that look like? Is that a focus on supply? What are pharmacies, what do they need to do to speed things up or get more robust efforts going there?
Yeah, it's about making sure we're reaching more pharmacies, that we are making sure they have the supply needed to ensure that boosters are available in pharmacies across the country and in communities that are harder to reach. So it's just expanding access, it's expanding supply, getting to more communities, and building on the steps we've already taken to date. Go ahead.
A question on shipping vaccines overseas. As part of the announcement today, the administration wants to accelerate shipments overseas, 200 doses in 100 days. What is enabling that acceleration? Is it higher production? Is it, you know, shifting from domestic use to international use? Can you explain a little more about that?
Well, we've always committed to doing both domestic and international use. I don't believe it's taking away from our domestic supply. Yeah, it's expediting our plans to provide vaccines to the global community. We've also been able to move more quickly as it relates to giving vaccines to a lot of countries because we've done this before. There's a blueprint. And in the initial stages, I think many of you may remember, there were sometimes logistical or other hurdles we had to get through with countries. Now we have a blueprint and ability to do that, so it can move a little more quickly. But I can check and see if there's more detail on you know, how we expedited it logistically.
And China says they're contributing as many, if not even more, doses than the United States is. Obviously, the administration said that they're the primary, the biggest provider of vaccines overseas. How do you compare what the U.S. is doing and what China is doing? How do you compare those two vaccination efforts?
Well, I don't have their numbers in front of me, but what I can convey is that we are providing doses to the global community with no strings attached. I don't think that's the case for every dose from China.
Should have an assessment of how effective the Chinese vaccine is?
I don't have any from here. You should ask the public health experts that. Go ahead.
I just want to follow up on the issue of domestic air travel that came up.
Sure.
You said nothing is off the table. Does that mean there are active discussions about a vaccine requirement or some other change when it comes to domestic air travel? Can you clarify how active that conversation is, whether we could see something before Christmas?
I don't have anything to predict on that front. There are active discussions about a range of things that will never see the light of day every single day. And our COVID team is going to continue to bring ideas forward, continue to make recommendations. We'll see what they come up with and what's discussed. And the president takes their advice and counsel very seriously. But I would say there's discussions about a range of options every day. Go ahead.
Thanks, Jen. I have two questions about the upcoming Democracy Summit.
Sure.
So there's been concern among some Asian countries that the summit is putting them in an uncomfortable position because they feel like they have to choose between the U.S. and China. What is your response to that? And Russia's foreign ministry and the Chinese embassy also raised concerns recently about the summit. So what is your response to their criticism that the summit is dividing countries?
Well, our objective with the summit is to bring together 110 governments representing diverse democratic experiences around the world, as well as civil society and private sector leaders, to discuss how we can work together to protect democracy around the world, to stand up for democracy around the world. That's nothing we're going to apologize for, no matter what the criticism is from any country around the world. And it's an opportunity to also be clear that we should always be, no democracy is perfect. No democracy is ever final. And we should continue to build on that, discuss, engage, encourage positive change. So that's our objective. And hopefully countries who participate will feel this is an opportunity to be a part of that positive change moving forward. Go ahead.
Thank you, Jen. I appreciate it. So on these new COVID guidelines, only the new transportation mask mandate or the extension has a date attached to it. That is extended to March 18th. The rest of the measures are in place for the duration of the public health emergency. How long does the administration anticipate the public health emergency portion of this will last?
Well, I can't give an end date on that because we're still in the middle of fighting the pandemic. I will note that there are a couple of pieces that we have dates on in terms of when they will start. I'm not suggesting that was your question, but that is the determination that will be made by the CDC, by our public health experts, not a political determination. So we will wait for their guidance on that.
The 212F restrictions, though, were in place for 20 months, nearly 2 years. Is it your anticipation that we could see some of these measures in place for that long, or is it more a matter of weeks in this case?
I can't give you an assessment of that because we're going to base it on the public health guidelines, what steps we need to take to protect the American people. Go ahead.
Funding. Thank you so much.
Can I just ask on the funding really
sure.
quickly? Most of these programs, if they require funding, are being funded by previous congressional packages and anything that's left over. Is there anything left over from the CARES Act and the American Rescue Plan, or does the administration need to go back to Congress to ask for more money if it were to, say, reimburse insurance companies for some of these costs?
Well, there's also funding that was in the American Rescue Plan. There's funding that's been proposed in Build Back Better. I'm not aware of additional funding being requested beyond that at this point. Go ahead.
Okay, thank you. Just follow up on international travel restrictions.
Sure.
Just to get an idea of what the general direction here is. You said the administration is going to assess day to day. And for example, today we learned that Norway is suspecting a large cluster of cases linked to the new variant. So what's the idea? Is it to multiply restrictions or is it to lift those already in place because the variant has spread already and nothing can be done to delay the spread?
Well, we're going to assess both, and it will be assessed by the CDC, by our health and medical experts, and we'll rely on their guidance. So I wouldn't expect the lifting of restrictions before we know more about the variant. We will continue to evaluate if additional restrictions need to be put in place. None of these are meant to be permanent. None of them are meant to be a punishment. They're all put in place to protect the American people, to hopefully save more lives. Go ahead in the back. Go in the back.
I wanted to ask about the second Omicron case from today.
Sure.
The CDC is saying that it was the individual who tested positive was at a convention in New York. Is there concern at all about super spreader events like that, where this individual was there, or with what happened in California.
So the CDC is the best entity to speak to contract tracing, which they will do extensive contact tracing on. And I would also point to the fact that the Minnesota Public Health Department also has a press conference coming up at noon. So I will let them speak to how they're approaching that.
Jen, on the top of this,
if I could also ask you about the at-home COVID test.
Sure.
The test, when can Americans expect to be able to use their private insurance to cover this? I know that there's going to have to be a rulemaking process out of HHS and Treasury, might be one more agency, labor in there. When can Americans expect to be able to actually use this coverage?
That rulemaking, we expect to get clear guidance by mid-January. So that's really the next step. Beyond that, I can't predict at this point. But we are going to get free tests in places at like rural health clinics and community health centers. That's something we're going to start to do this month. Go ahead.
Travel restriction. You keep pushing this narrative.
Go ahead. Okay, let her finish. Let her finish. Sir, she was asking a question. Go ahead. We will expect to learn more about that process in mid-January. They'll give an update by then. Go ahead.
Two questions on the COVID, winter COVID plan. One question, one clarification. So the administration in that plan is releasing a safe school checklist, and it says to give schools a clear game plan on how to get as many staff and students vaccinated as possible. So is the president pushing for vaccine mandates for kids, or would they support, or would he support a vaccine mandate for school boards to impose that?
Well, I think we gave more description of this, but let me give you an example. And as somebody who has kids in elementary school, this other people may relate to this. Most elementary schools, or a lot of them out there, if there's somebody who tests positive for COVID, that often means that people with close contact also have to quarantine for a set number of days. That's the process in a lot of different schools. These decisions are made school district to school district. One of the pieces you'll hear him talk about that has been implemented in other places is looking into this question of whether there can be additional testing that can be administered in school so that you can keep kids in school. The objective is to keep kids in school. So that's kind of the most vibrant example I would give you of what we're really talking about here.
And the clarification, so the winter plan, the administration is pushing pharmacies, or is the administration pushing pharmacies to make more robocalls and robo-texts to people? It says millions in this.
Yeah.
Because I can't get CVS to stop calling me.
Well, look, I think what our objective is here is to make sure people know where they can get a vaccine and get a booster. And a lot of people are still confused about that. And access, we know, is a huge barrier. So I'm sorry about all the calls. That means CVS is just, I guess, doing a very effective job. But that's what our objective is. I have to wrap this up in a minute. But Patsy, go ahead. Patsy, go ahead.
So just following up Chris's question.
Simon, I answered a question on this. Let Patsy. Simon, I answered a question on this. Let's let Patsy ask a question. It's not effective to scream over your colleagues in here. Let's let Patsy ask a question.
Following up on Chris's question on sending vaccine doses abroad, can you specifically talk about the plan to send directly to humanitarian settings and conflict zones? Do you have any idea as to where, who you'll be working with?
Can you say the beginning part of your question again, Patsy? Sorry.
Well, part of the administration's plan is to send out 200 million doses in the next 100 days, including humanitarian settings and conflict zones.
Yeah.
Can you tell specifically about that, please?
Yeah, Patsy, and I'll get you more details on this, but what we typically do is we work through trusted global health partners like the United Nations, other NGOs that are trusted who can get humanitarian assistance and aid, including vaccine doses, into communities. So that's typically how we would approach it.
Okay. Just another follow-up on a question that my colleague asked, and you said you'll give more specifics on the Democracy Summit.
Yeah.
Which is, what are the criteria in determining who gets invited? Why are you, for example, leaving out Sri Lanka and Bangladesh and inviting Pakistan? Why are you inviting Kosovo and Serbia but not Bosnia?
Well, our objective here was to invite a range of countries, a range of civil society leaders and other private sector leaders to have a discussion about democracy. It does not mean that we are that everyone we're inviting we're giving a stamp of approval on. Every democracy is a work in progress, and it doesn't mean that we are giving the opposite of a stamp of approval or a negative stamp to people who are not invited. This is just meant to be to include and invite a diverse set of voices, countries who can speak to our global effort to protect democracy. George, I'll have to be the last one.
Beijing Olympics, if you don't mind, if you have any more updates on whether the president has made his decision on the Beijing Olympic, and whether the decision-making process include considerations on human and women rights in light of the treatment of the Chinese tennis player Peng Shuai after she disclosed that she was sexually mistreated by a Chinese official.
I don't have an update today. I will say, broadly speaking, as I've conveyed before, that of course any decision takes into account a range of issues, including human rights, our concerns about them, issues we have been quite outspoken on. George, let's do George and Amish, and then we got to wrap it up. Go ahead, George.
I wanted to see if you could clarify a situation on the continued steel tariffs on the U.S.